بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله تعالى will continue our journey to be رباني، and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from among the ربانيين. اللهم آمين يا رب العالمين. And this is the part 6, and إن شاء الله should be the last part, because بإذن الله تعالى next week بإذن الله, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the blessing to be from among those who will be observing Ramadan this year. Inshallah, we're going to have a beautiful program. We have met as a team, alhamdulillah, and we're trying to get the blessing and reap the maximum of the blessing of Ramadan despite the situation that we live. Most of our activities is going to be online, but may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the end of the stay home order, will be able inshallah to come back to the masjid, but to carry on some of the good habits that we have learned and we started to do during this staying home by staying connected online. That's also another way to alhamdulillah spread the word of Allah, to share the knowledge, and to help each other gaining more piety and be more able to be committed into gain righteousness. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala, وَتَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدُوَانِ. We have been talking about, you know, one of the main part of the journey of the Rabbani, as we said, is the dhikr. The dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come to really put back, you know, to put together the whole structure of the iman, to hold it and to give it that firmness, and to help the traveler to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have that, you know, three levels, three component of a pious person to be by Allah, to Allah, and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have explained in the previous, alhamdulillah, the previous sessions of the journey to be Rabbin. We have mentioned about the dhikr something very important, and you know, it's really important to underline it again and to put some more emphasis on it, which is the dhikr, it's not part external of the debt. It's not part external that we require to bring it when we need it and we put it on the side, then we get it back when we need. And we said the dhikr is actually part that is embedded within the self. It need to be embedded part of the self. It need to be part of our character. It need to be like the water that we drink to stay alive, and the food. We need to have the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as such. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Al-Ahzab, يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا وسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا. Or you who believe, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a match of remembrance and celebrate His praise in the morning and the evening. And you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we have mentioned last time, that He's commanding us to keep in a constant remembrance. Not for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we have said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is Al-Ghaniyul Hamid, but because for us, so it is a necessity for the believer to be in connection of the dhikr. And that's what we have mentioned last time, to try to, you know, just give enough evidences, walhamdulillah ta'ala, from the Quran, from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for us to understand the importance of the dhikr. In Surah Al-Ra'd, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قال ألا بذكر الله قال الذين آمنوا وَتَطَمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Those who believe and their heart find assurance, find satisfaction with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after this, so look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is describing for us as a fact. He said, those who believe, how do they find satisfaction? How they do find assurance in their heart? How they find that tranquility, that peace, and so on. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it comes with the remembrance of Allah. So this is a fact, this is a reality, this is a description. Now, the ayah that comes after it it settled a rule, a principle, a divine law. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. It's not actually only by thee, it's not by, it's not بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Is it not by the remembrance of Allah that the hearts find their rest and peace and satisfaction? So this ayah comes, is like telling, it's very obvious that the believer found satisfaction with the dhikr of Allah, because the dhikr of Allah, it meant to provide that satisfaction. The dhikr of Allah is the way how the angels, they live. The dhikr of Allah is the food and the water of the angels. As it is the food and the water for the angels, they do not eat. The only way to give them, you know, life is the dhikr of Allah. The same thing for the heart and the soul of the human being. The only thing that keep them alive is the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know that we have two parts of the body, that it requires all the physical, you know, need and maintenance and so on, and the heart and the soul, the need for the dhikr of Allah. We said this is the first basic and the first level that every believer need to be committed to, engaged to, if he's truly, sincerely want to have success in this life. The next step within the realm of looking at the dhikr of Allah as a necessity in our life is to continue to build, as we have said, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that, قَالَ وَالَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا زَادَهُمْ هُدَى وَآتَاهُمْ تَقْوَاهُمْ. Those who come to get to the kindness, to the guidance, to strive into the path of the guidance, Allah add them guidance, increase them in guidance, and He help them and show them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them the element and the way how to gain more piety. And this is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you see. And when we say striving to get the guidance, that is actually the action, the dynamic action of the dhikr. The third level, as we have mentioned in the dhikr, when someone comes to the level of being grateful to Allah, and we said Luqman alayhi salam, he's been given the gift of the hikmah, of the wisdom, because he was a grateful, thankful servant. And we mentioned the story of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has he always, when he's been asked about his worship alayhi salam, despite the fact that he was forgiven, he used to say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala akunu abdan shakura, should I not be a thankful servant? This is alhamdulillah, we have mentioned them last time and we have analyzed them. Who want to get more details about that, he can go to the session, to the previous session. The dynamic dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we want to see now is what are the type of the dhikr. And when you do such type of the dhikr, what will the interaction that will be happening between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, as the last part, if we have time, to see in the way how to make ourselves, remind ourselves the need of the dhikr. Remind ourselves. It's like there's a layer that we need to put forward to help us be in a state of the dhikr all the time, insha'Allah ta'ala. So, the dhikr from min nahiyat al-amal, from the type, from the side of the action or the dynamic action of the dhikr, it being divided by the scholar of knowledge or the ahlul ilmi to seven categories. So there is an action of the dhikr, you know, divided in seven categories, and every category is going to be the focus or the role of one of the body of one of our part, one of the body part that we have. So he's saying, "Qala al-dhikru." There's the first one, the eyes, the remembrance of the eyes, dhikrul ainay. Then dhikrul udunay, then the remembrance of the ears, then dhikrul lisan, the remembrance of the tongue, then dhikrul yadain, the remembrance associated to the action of the hands, then dhikru al-qadam, to the feet, then dhikrul qalb, to the heart, then dhikru al-ruhu, the soul. So subhanAllah, it comes from all the senses, goes to the heart, the tool that we need to act and work and to walk and travel, and then comes to the heart, as we said, and the soul. So dhikrul aynayn, dhikrul aynayn. What will be the best remembrance done with the eyes? So dhikrul aynayni, it's subhanAllah to contemplate, to reflect. But is more that when you contemplate, to reflect, that will be the mind. But the mind and the eyes are connected. But the best, the peak, if you can say, of dhikrul aynayn is the tears. Are the tears. But does not mean if someone does not have tears, so he's not making dhikr with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his eyes. But we're saying, subhanAllah, that goosebump that someone feels when he's remembering Allah, when he thinks about some of the threatening that might happen to a person that is mentioned in the Quran, to interact with it, to feel such a thing, that's subhanAllah from the dhikr. So when we say the aynayn, what you see with the aynayn. What you see, it's going to provide you an image, and this image, it comes with the data, and this data is going to have ideas. So how to process this idea with these eyes to make it in a way of the dhikr. So when you look at something haram, lowering the gaze is a dhikr. It is a remembrance of the eyes. When you look at something like the Quran, and you'll be staring and looking again and again to the Quran, it's a dhikr. When you look at your parents and, you know, adoring them, respecting them, it's a dhikr. When you're reading a book of knowledge, it's a dhikr. When you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creation and contemplate on it, and thinking, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala, inna fi khalq as-samawati wal-ardi wa ikhtilaf al-layli wan-nahari la ayatin li ulil albab. Indeed, in the creation of the heaven and the earth, and the alternation of the day and the night are indeed ayat, signs for people of understanding. That's why I said the eyes are connected. Eyes and ears are connected with the mind, this process of reflection. Now, the problem when someone does not make the dhikr, so what will be the illness, what will be the problem that the eyes will have? Wal-iyadu billah is al-ghishawa, there will be cover on the eyes. So the cover on the eyes make one to not caring about lowering his or her gaze. The cover on the eyes make one to not reflect on the creation of Allah. The cover on the eye makes someone to not see the truth, to not get reminded by the Quran and so on. So these are the dhikr of al-aynayn. So someone, look, if we take one by one, we can have like a whole dhikr to encompass all the being of the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhikrul udunayn yakunu bil isgha'i. Dhikrul udunayn, the remembrance of the ears comes with the listening. And listening, subhanallah, one of the quality that if someone, you know, work on the listening, it really change his and her behavior and their path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the listening is greater in a way than the seeing. They might come into one level, but the listening, subhanAllah, is closer to the heart. The listening where you hear. And the problem, you know, why I'm saying this is a greater quality, and this the ability to listen help one to really be strong in his and her iman, because the problem, it's not in listening, the problem is in non-listening. So the majority of the people, they do not listen. So the problem is how to strive to make the ears and the faculty of listening to be in the service of the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you listen, then you'll be reminded. If you're going to be reminded, you're going to be thinking. If you are thinking, you're going to try to change. But if someone, for example, talk to you, and all your mind is to you talk, then while the person is talking to you, you're not listening. So how to be a person who can listen, first to try to remove the cover from the ears. And the removing the cover from the ears, is, subhanAllah, that cover that being put there by diseases like the arrogance, diseases like the showing off, diseases that someone he thinks that's superior to others, and actually that's part of the arrogance. So the listening, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Al-Mulk about the people that will be thrown in hellfire, wal-iyadu billah. The khazana, the guardian of the hellfire, they will be telling them, you didn't have a warner who came to warn you about that? Qalu bala. Yes, it happened. There's people telling us about the Quran, there's people telling us about the Day of Judgment, but we didn't. Look what they said, we didn't listen. لو كنا نسمع أو نعقل ما كنا من أصحاب السير وفي أصحاب السير. If we just used to listen, if we had that capability to listen and then to comprehend and process it into our mind, would not have been today here standing by the garden of hellfire والعياذ بالله to be thrown in hellfire. So the listening, it becomes, subhanAllah, a tool, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when he described the people of understanding, he said, الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَهُ. Those who listen to the speech, listen to the reminder, and they follow the best of it. And look, subhanAllah, يَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَهُ. So from listening to follow the best of it, it has a processing of the data, processing of the information would help someone to think and contemplate, and then he chooses from what he had or she had listened, things that goes with their situation to implement it, to help them in their path to Allah. So it will be to pick from what you have listened, the best, I mean not the best in the speech, because in the speech it might be the best part of the speech, good for that one, person A, and the other one is for person B, because they have different cases, different situation. And this is between the listening and the implementation, there's a processing, and this here comes the contemplation and the mind. And as I'm saying this, the one of the greatest worship is to contemplate, to think, and thinking helps someone to really change, and asking a question within himself and herself, and then come to people of knowledge to help them to understand. And that's how the process which is included in this dhikr. So you see, dear brother and respected sisters, that the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not limited to just with the tongue. The dhikr is with the eyes, the dhikr is with the hearing. So if what I see in my eyes, if I have signed that, I will not be able to lower my gaze, so I have an issue. So if I want to increase my dhikr of eyes, I have first to get rid of some disease in the heart who's not, you know, being, let's say, have that shame, have that modesty to not look to the haram. Because looking to the prohibited things, still we have an issue. We have an issue mainly of hiddenness. I will say most of the people who are true believer, alhamdulillah, if they look at something haram, it's not because they don't care. It's because of a weakness of the nafs, because of the absence of Allah at that moment from their heart. So how to do that? It's like, why not bring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to your heart by the dhikr? Then you will be able to have that modesty to be ashamed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is going to help you to strive and struggle to next time lower your gaze. And as soon as you start to lowering your gaze, then the dhikr of al-aynayn start to have its effect into your soul. The dhikr of al-udhunayn, as we have said, dhikr al-udhunayn, the remembrance of the udhunayn, of the ears, by the listening. And this is a very important point. It might take a whole lecture, the listening on itself, but we'll continue as we have our journey. And this is just some elements, inshallah, to help us all together try to use it. And especially we are in this blessed month of Sha'ban, and soon we're going to get in Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala. It's a great opportunity for us to take all this element together, put them together in a great recipe, and out of the recipe we're going to make a whole planning of ibadah that help us to be rabbaniyina, insha'Allah. So the ذكر اللسان, the ذكر of the tongue, قال بالحمد والثنى, قال بالحمد والثنى. The ذكر of the tongue comes with thanking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praising of Allah, تسبيح of Allah, تكبير, تهليل, and so on. In the other hand, we have to refrain the tongue, so to have it to be soft in the way of the remembrance of Allah is to refrain and watch the tongue, to not lie, to not backbite, to not gossip, to not engage in something that it does not really concern you. And this is subhanAllah, you see, you have always the positive side and to get rid from the negative side. And then we will not be able to truly make a true dhikr of lisan, of the tongue, when we in the same time, by making the hamd of Allah, by making the praises of Allah, by making the tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to try in the same time to get rid of the ill action of the tongue. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in many of the hadith, especially in the hadith of Mu'adh, that he told him that the harvest of the tongue leads to the hellfire, wal-iyadu billah. So how can someone shield himself or herself from the ill harvest of the tongue and make the tongue having the harvest that they get them close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by alhamdi wa tahleen? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this regard, he helped us even to give us the numbers. You know, after the salat, do 33 of this, 33 of this, 33 of this. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, wallahu akbar. And he told us before you sleep, you know, what he said to Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. So you see, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaching us and instructing us to have the dhikr of the lisan, but in the same time by cleansing our tongue to not fall into ill action and to fall into the ill harvest of the tongue, which will lead, wal-iyadu billah, to the punishment and to the doom of the punishment of Allah, to the doom of the hellfire. After the tongue, the hands. The hands, the dhikr of the hands comes with giving, sharing, sadaqah, helping the needy. And subhanAllah, a generous hand, that's the dhikr of the yad. SubhanAllah, that's the dhikr. So I say, how can my hand do dhikr? Stop your hand to not hit people with no right, to have your hand shed blood, to have your hand insult people, even because there's an action with the hand that it can be, you know, a sign of insult. If you use your hand to get close to people, to give, and especially by giving and giving the sadaqah, that one of the greatest action of the hand in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How the yadayn, how the hands will not be, you know, acting the opposite of the dhikr. When the hand will be used to steal, when the hand will be using to do things that haram and not permissible and so on. So you see, the dhikr, it's not an active action, you know, or actually a passive, without being active in what might oppose the dhikr of the hand, the dhikr of the tongue, the dhikr of the ears, and the dhikr of the eyes. So we have to work on both sides, the side to help ourselves make the dhikr in the way that it pleases Allah, and the other side to open up the gate or the door or the path to the dhikr by trying to eliminate the obstacle to the dhikr. For the aynayn, not lowering the gaze. For the udunayn, to hear and listen things, lies, to hear, you know, things that they are far, you know, keep someone, you know, vain talk. To listen to some lyrics, and especially those music who had, you know, talk about always inviting for to doing sins. And without entering into a lot of details, if you want really your heart to be a recipient for the iman, you have to cleanse your heart from anything that is negative, from anything that is really, you know, repels whatever pure in the heart. Dhikr al-yadayn, we have mentioned. Al-qadam, how the feet have their dhikr. He's saying, qala bil-juhdi wal-wafa, by having strive, struggle, and being faithful. Here we put the faithful here because when someone has an amana, his trust, he's not going to say, oh, this is far, I'm not going to do it. You're going to do it. Why? Because you are a truthful person. So you make your feet make the dhikr. You make your feet make your dhikr because you want to join the jama'ah, the congregation. It might be, you know, walking fast and going. And in here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a great gift. Look, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith, the meaning of which saying, like if you go to the masjid, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us again this opportunity for all our community to be back and visit the masjid, is only for the masjid that you will have this. One step, every time you make one step, you have a hasana and erase one evil deed. Imagine, subhanAllah. And then if you're driving the car, you make the analogy maybe by the rotation of the spin of the wheels. And this is, subhanAllah, only for the masjid. So you're making your steps toward Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by those steps erasing sins and elevating you with the greats, with levels into his nearness subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, anyone who goes and travel, in travel seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he or she dies while they are traveling for the sake of Allah, even going to the masjid, going to the way of Allah, to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever dies in that state, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admit him in his rahmah, as he said in Surah An-Nisa, وَمَنْ يَخْرُجْ مُهَاجِرًا مِنْ بَيْتِهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ أَدْرَكَهُ الْمَوْتُ فَقَدْ وَقَعَ أَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Whoever who leaves his home, seeking to go to Allah and His Messenger, go to please Allah, to do an action, seeking with it the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after, while is he in his way to it, death come to this person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, then his reward is on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will take care of the reward of this noble person, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah An-Nisa. The next one is dhikrul qalbi, the remembrance of the heart. Fadhikrul qalbi comes with two things, bil khawfi wal raja, with fear and hope. Now, just before to come to this point, when we're talking about the feet, what opposed the dhikr of the feet is to use our own feet to travel, to go where? To places where there's Allah's way is violated. Whereas Allah's laws is violated. We go to places when the haram is practiced. Then you make in your feet to be, subhanAllah, a means of not dhikr, but a means of violating the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see, maybe before we go farther to say to the heart, to remind you and remind ourselves that all the limbs that we have are a gift from Allah. A gift from Allah, to be very specific, a gift that is a trust from Allah to you. So the hand that we have, it does not belong to us. The feet do not belong to us. The skin does not belong to us. It belongs to Allah. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He entrusted you, this body part, subhanah, to help you be guided and help you to fulfill your purpose in this life. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away your free will, when at the time of death, and we know all of that, then you lose control of all these limbs, of all this body part. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in many places in the Quran that the hand is going to witness against you, that the feet is going to witness against you, that the skin is going to witness against you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hatta qala hatta idha ma ja'uha shahida alayhim sam'uhum wa absaruhum wa juluduhum, till when they came in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being about to be thrown in hellfire, they want to, you know, to say, you know, about the judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, their eyes, their ears, their all skin, so everything will witness against them. So the people, they said to their skin, to their hand, to their eyes, said, why are you witnessing against us? And they will say, antaqana Allahu alladhi antaqa kull shay. Is Allah who made us to speak? We belong to Allah, we don't belong to you. And Allah gave us to you as a trust to help you fulfill your purpose of your life. Now that we were with you and we came back to Allah, He's the one who created us and been entrusted to you, then our mission now is to say what we have witnessed from you. And this is subhanAllah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, and this is in Surah Fussilat, He said, the issue of the human being that they didn't really believe that their own skin is going to witness against them. Actually, the worst, it's not that, the worst that they thought that Allah does not know much of what we're doing in this life. قال ذلك أنكم ظننتم, that Allah does not know. وَذَلِكُمْ ظَنُّكُمُ الَّذِي ظَنَنْتُمْ بِرَبِّكُمْ أَرْدَاكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And your assumption about your Lord that He does not know, subhanAllah, much of what you're doing make you to really be a loser. That's what cast you, وَلَعِيَّذُ بِاللَّهِ, into the loss or into the torment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is said, we'll continue to the part which is the very important one, is al-qalbu, the heart. The dhikr of the heart need to be balanced, fear and hope, fear and hope. And the fear and hope, fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hoping the mercy of Allah. And the fear make you to push you to work more, and the hope maybe to be longing to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then subhanAllah is like a balance. Like, you know, you see the rail, it has two lines. So it's like a balance. The train cannot, you know, travel on one of them. It's going to be, the balance is on both, on two. So it's like one is hope and the other one is fear. And other scholar, they give the parable of a bird that he's, you know, only can fly by two wings. One wing is the fear of Allah, the other wing is the hope of Allah, and they say the head and the body that driving is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in Surah Al-Anfal, describing the true believer, قال وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُ هُوَ are the true believer. قال, those when they hear, look, when they hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala name is mentioning, I can just use some of the translation here to read it together. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying in this, قَالَ إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. You're going to see the dhikr, how in what we have said is going to be all comes to the heart. Everything is going to come centralized in the heart. Because when I see and I don't have cover, then what is going to go? It's going to go to the heart. When I have, subhanAllah, listen, something good is going to go to the heart. If I cannot listen, it means that I have cover in my heart. The cover in my heart, it resulted on a covering on the ears and the cover on the eye. So that's why it centralized all in the heart. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam قال ألا إن في الجسد مضغة إذا صلحت صلحة الجسد كله. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said there is a piece of flesh in the heart. If it goes sound, the whole body goes sound. It is the heart, and the same for the spiritual heart. If the heart goes sound, everything goes up. So if the heart has light, you're going to have light in the ears, light in the eyes, light in the hand, light in the feet. So you're going to act in the way of the light, which is the way of Allah, walk in the way of the light, see with the light, and listen with the light. Why? Because the heart is filled with light. And the heart is acting when it has light in fear and in hope. So listen to this ayah, Surah Al-Anfal, Surah number 8 and ayah number 2. قَالَ إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. The believers are only those who, when Allah is mentioned, feel a fear in their hearts. Allah is mentioned, so is listening. So someone said Allahu Rahman. Someone recited Quran, وَهُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِ. He listened that. He realized this is talking about Allah. It has, subhanAllah, an impact in the heart. This impact in the heart is expressed by fear. And this fear, by feel venerating Allah, feel humility to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُ. Look, ذُكِرَ. The name of Allah is remembered. The name of Allah is mentioned. قَلْ feel a fear in their hearts. And when his verses are recited unto them, they increase their faith. The verses increase them in faith. Recited, which is mean, this is the dhikr of the eyes, the ears, subhanAllah. Again, so when they heard the verses of Allah, they contemplate, they listen with focus, it increased their faith. And they put their trust in their Lord. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُوا. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ. And on their Lord, they put their trust. The next ayah, قَالَ who are these people? الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. Who establish regular prayers and spend out of the gift we have given them for sustenance. So the action of the dhikr, with the hand you give the zakat, with the whole your body you make the salah. The whole body making the salah. You have the khushu' into the heart, the hands, subhanAllah, around, you know, in the position that it need to be in the salah, and then you prostrate, you make your sujood, you sit, and all of the whole body with the heart and the soul in full devotion to Allah. And that's the salah, is the comprehensive of the dhikr. As you remember, we said the dhikr is a necessity to the heart and to the believer, and started with respecting and observing the salah in its time. That's how we connect things. So all the action of the dhikr come to be, subhanAllah, fully and completely, almost completely expressed into the salah. To give the sadaqah is way of the dhikr. And this is all what is going to be driven by the heart. And this is, subhanAllah, and, you know, inspired and commended by the heart. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. It is they who are the believer in truth. And in the other translation he said, those are the believers truly. Those are the believers truly. Such in truth are the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them a grades of dignity, which is their Lord, and forgiveness and generous sustenance. As Allah ulaika lahum qala lahum darajatun inda rabbihim wa maghfiratun wa rizqun kareem. This is the heart. Without going into more details about the fear and the hope, but those are, you know, come together to help. You know, fear of Allah, more veneration, more humility, and that humility and fear, if it goes too excessive, then someone is going to feel not even acting, feel like he's willing to die. And no, we have to work and act. So the hope comes to bring you to the banners, and the hope of, you know, building and having, you know, joy in this life and waiting for the joy, the greater joy in the hereafter, and so on, and longing for the rahmah of Allah, longing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you as gifts, and so on. And this is the banners in the heart. What about the remembrance of the soul? The remembrance of the soul, as he's saying here, comes with a rida, to be pleased with Allah. And the submission, two things. At-taslimu wal-rida. To fully submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like in the situation we are in. You do what you can do, and the rest you submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I say submit to Allah, it does not mean I will be passive. Be careful. Submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you trust in Allah. You did what you can do. So we say, why should I be scared? Why should I frightening myself? Why should I be panicking? Why should I be listening to people who do not have iman, who do not have any means to find security and safety, who people, rely on their skills, on their money, on their businesses. These people are panicking by nature because they're seeing losing everything. And you as a believer, you have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If there is any believer think that he's going to lose Allah, yes, we do lose Allah when we forget ourselves and we forget Allah and be heedless and we be panicking and frightened and terrifying because we don't know what is going to happen tomorrow. Tomorrow, as we'll be in always say, don't we repeat it, is in the hand of Allah. Tomorrow is not created yet. That's why the believer, truly the believer, does not have the right to have fear. I mean, we are scared because that's our nature. We are weak. But we think of it with reason, with the iman, we do not have the right. If you say to yourself, look, you do not have the right to be sad. You do not have worrying, that's fine, but worrying not to consume yourself. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Ghari Hira, in Ghari Thawr, in the cave of Thawr, him and Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Abu Bakr, he was so sad. He was not scared, because he's trusting Allah. Whatever is happening is going to be happening by the will of Allah. That's why he has surrendered Abu Bakr, fully submitted, and pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His concern said, what if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is killed at that time? Then there will not be Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala la tahzan, do not be sad, ya Abu Bakr. Allah is with us. What do you think about two? Allah is there third. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the third of them, so nobody can get to you except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will. And if Allah will, then there is a wisdom behind it that we have to submit to it and accept it. That's why if you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with you, first you have to be pleased with Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. He was pleased with them and they were pleased with him in Surah At-Tawbah. In Surah, many of the places in the Quran. يا أيتها النفس المطمئنة ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية فادخلي في عبادي راضية مرضية. راضية, you are pleased. And I'm going to make you pleased. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can we be pleased by Allah? How can us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say you have to be pleased with me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with you. To accept, to be pleased with Allah, it means to have that contentment. To be pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us as destiny. To be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for us as sustenance. To be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever trial we are enduring. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you the tools how to find your fortress of tranquility, how you'll find your peace of mind in the midst of the biggest of the difficulty. All what you ask for the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That, all of it, what I'm talking about in the dhikr of Allah, is all together. It comes centralized in the heart, and the soul comes with its contentment, which is full submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The full submission, as I said, it's not a passive action, it's a very active, dynamic action. It comes with comprehension, it comes with thinking, it comes with pondering. Then you realize the best thing that you can offer to yourself is to say, I submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever is going to happen is going to be good. Wallahi al-azim is going to be good. Just say it to yourself. Whatever is going to be happening is going to be good. The worst thing, as I always say it, and I always say to remind myself and you as we have been studying it from our scholars and before our scholars, from our beloved great teacher, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The worst of the thing is to be in hellfire. If you're not in a hellfire, everything is good. Wallahi, everything is good. Then if you have, anxiety and problem is we made it. We made it. We fabricated. We invented. Why? Because we are believing in things that they are illusions, does not exist and do not exist. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Inshallah, we'll finish. I should have stopped here, but I promise, inshallah, to go farther. And we'll stop at the Maghrib prayer, inshallah ta'ala, which in our location will be at 8:05 bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Or before that, inshallah. طيب، after knowing all the type of the dhikr, the let's say the positive action, the active one, the action that will help us to have the dhikr of all this body part that we have mentioned, and also the opposite action, which is to cleanse and remove the obstacle, like heedlessness, cover on the eyes, on the heart, and so on, to help us have the dhikr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala fadhkuruni adhkurkum, remember me, I remember you. And this is we have mentioned last time of one of the story of the companion. And imagine yourself, if you say, Ya Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Ya Abd. Say, literally say, Oh my servant. We have mentioned a story before. It's nice to mention it today as a reminder. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had invited, one, you know, he had someone traveler, and one of the a great virtue, a quality of Ibrahim, he used to always have a guest, so he shared his food. He found someone and he brought him to his house, you know, as his great habit to honor the guest. And he only requested only one small thing. He said, can you please say the right of the food? He said, what is the right of the food? To say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, simply to say in the name of Allah, the creator of the food. He said, are you imposing on me your God? I will not. And then he left. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, subhanallah, kind of was reproached by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He told him, you know, the servant of mine, he's almost 70 years or so. I've been providing for him all his life without worshipping me. And you, he came to you for one meal, and you were not nice to him. Subhanallah. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, this is the remembrance of Allah. He's remembering a one who's not believing in him. Ibrahim alayhi salam went out seeking for this person, you know, in a plain desert here and here. He found him after, you know, a long walk and long search. He told him, can you please come back? He said, you know, your case is strange. You know, you just let me go when I get mad, and then you came back and to run behind me and asked me, begging me to come back. He said, indeed, is my Lord who was reproaching me for in your case. He said, how's that? He said that he's been providing you for all these years and he didn't stop that. And me, his servant, I kind of, you know, been hard on you to offer you one meal. So this man, he said, a Lord who says such a thing, he's the Lord who is merciful, and he's the Lord, the true creator, and he's the true God to be worshipped, and he accepted Islam. Another story with Ibrahim alayhi salam, when a man was saying, you know, he's remembering his idol, and the idol, he called it literally sanam. Sanam. Sanam would mean idol, statue. Ya sanami, ya sanami. His tongue, you know, subhanAllah, made a mistake. Instead of the noon, the N sound, he said the M, the meme sound. Qala ya samad. And samad is the one who's the great, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it in Surah Al-Ikhlas. Allahu samad. So he said, when he said ya samadi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala ya abdi, O my servant. So the story, like Ibrahim said, Ya Allah, he didn't mean to say Ya Samadi, he said Sanami. He said, Ajibtu laka, I'm really kind of astonished to your comment. And I'm not sure, by the way, if it was Ibrahim or Musa alayhi salam, but, you know, just for the moral of the story. He said, about your comment, he said, why Ya Allah? He said, even he did a mistake, he said Samadi. Is there any other samad in universe, in the cosmos beside me? He said, no, Ya Allah. He said, that's why I answered him. So to say this story, subhanAllah, imagine you say, Ya Allah, and Allah already knows you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remember you with your own name. And it's really powerful if you think about it. Just take your time and think about it. You say, Ya Allah, and Allah mentioned him there. If you mention Allah in a gathering, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he said in Hadith Qudsi, is going to mention you in a gathering better than the gathering, because the gathering that you want to mention Allah in is going to be a gathering of human beings. Allah is going to mention you in a gathering of high-ranked angels. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قال in Surah Al-Baqarah, أذكروني أذكركم. Do not mention, look at the gift and you say, oh, this is gift from Allah, alhamdulillah. Do not be people who know Allah through the gifts. Because if you know Allah through the gift, if you lose the gift, you forget about Allah. فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَا ابْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّ أَكْرَمَهُ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala try him and he will honor him, he said, oh, Allah honored me. But when he make it tight on him, he said, oh, Allah is disgracing me. So you see, when we only make the gift to be between us and Allah, when we make the, let's say, what motivates us to make dhikr of Allah are the gifts, then we have a problem, because Allah on a very thin line, on the edge. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after we're talking about the types of the dhikr, we are talking about ask Allah directly. Do not put gift between you and him. Do not make the reason of your prayer because just to ask Allah to increase your sustenance. Ask him, subhanAllah, to forgive you. Ask him to bring you close to you. Wallahi, your sustenance will be increased from the other side. You don't need to ask him. He is the provider. But do not make the gift of Allah as an intermediary between you and him. He didn't say, Uthkur ni'mati, I remember you. He didn't say, remember my gifts, I remember you. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the follower of Musa alayhi salam, they didn't have enough iman at the time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, remember my gift, I remember you. So through the gift, they appreciate Allah. And maybe in the second rank or second level, second stage, they will be appreciating the greatness of Allah. And just to be servant and being servant of Allah is a great thing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala, udhkuruni adhkurkum. Remember me, I remember you. And I read this beautiful, saying of a scholar. He put it together. قَالَ أُذْكُرُونِي بِالدُّعَاءِ أَذْكُرْكُمْ بِالْعَطَبِ إِعْطَاءِ الْأَلَهِ. Remember me with the dua. Make dua for me. I remember you back by giving you, showering you with the blessing and gifts. أَذْكُرُونِي بِالْخَوْفِ وَالرَّجَى أَذْكُرْكُمْ بِالْأَمْنِ وَالْعَطَى. Remember me with fear and hope. I remember you back with safety, security, and giving you what you help you to be secure and safe. أذكروني بالصدق أذكركم بالرزق. Remember me with your action of truthfulness, with being truthful to me, truthful to your commitment, truthful to your promises, truthful to your word. I will remember you with increase of sustenance and increase of blessing. أذكروني بالإنابة أذكركم بالإجابة. Remember me by keeping returning back to me. By keeping returning, by repenting, by asking forgiveness, by keeping returning to me, I remember you by answering all your dua. أذكروني بالمجاهدة أذكركم بالهداية. Remember me with the way of you striving. Show me that you're striving to do a better prayer today, to give the extra dollar tomorrow, and strive. When you do that thing, I'll remember you with increasing your guidance, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the end of Surah Al-Ankabut, قَالَ وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And those who strive in our sake, we certainly will guide them to our ways, and Allah is with those who are muhsinun. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be, make us from the muhsinin. أذكروني بالشكري أذكركم بالزيادة. Remember me by being grateful and thankful. I will remember you by increasing your favor. وَلَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. And if Allah, your Lord, has proclaimed, if you be grateful, I will increase you. I'll give you more. أذكروني بالصبري أذكركم بجزيل الأجري. Remember me with patience and they remember you with reward that does not have limit, infinite reward, no measure. إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. These, dear brother, respected sister, one of the comprehensive way of the dhikr. The dhikr, it has the dua, the fear, the hope, truthfulness, returning to Allah, striving, being grateful to Allah, thankful to Allah, patience, all of that is the dhikr. So you see, the dhikr is not only to say it with the tongue. The dhikr is a whole universe. That it really elevate you high, cleanse your heart, and purify your soul. I will, inshallah, the third part, I don't think we'll have the time to do it because it really require more analysis. Maybe, inshallah ta'ala, during Ramadan, when we'll have the time, we can do it. But I'll finish with this saying that being narrated on the authority of Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam. It's very profound saying. قال يقول ختم الملك الخير في ثلاث. The Malik, the angel who writing our deeds, made to Subhanallah. He's like Isa reporting to us. He's like saying that goodness and khair, the good thing, the good of the action of your action, can be seen from these three types or three categories. And the three categories, subhanAllah, it help us because when you look at a room from an angle, you're going to see, depends on what you're seeing from that angle. If you go from the other angle, it's going to be a slight different description. What we have been talking about is the structure of the dhikr, how you build it and how you raise it up. In this saying, you're going to come from an angle and to see this structure, how it will behave, how it will be acting, and it kind of give us other element to secure this fortress of the remembrance of Allah that help us in our journey to be Rabbin. So the goodness or the good deeds being, come to be summarized into these three action or three categories. He said, in speaking, and in being silent, and in contemplating and seeing. You see, so we put them together to reduce them to what you see and what you say and what you will be thinking when you are quiet. Three things. It's an amazing, as you say, it's very profound, alhamdulillah. He said, فَمَا كَانَ مِن مَنْطَقٍ فِي غَيْرِ ذِكْرٍ فَهُوَ لَغْوٌ. This is just to secure your structure. He said, any speech that is not directed within the remembrance of Allah, enjoy good, forbid evil, of course saying things that related to a contract, that part of the honoring the contract that you have signed with your employer and so on. But you're talking about any words when you speak without true purpose, valid purpose, and mainly when you speak not in the way of the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this person, this talk is laghu. Laghu, vain talk. Laghu is like a foam. It's going to be, subhanallah, coming against you. The second, وَمَا كَانَ مِن صَمْتٍ فِي غَيْرِ تَفَكُّرٍ فَهُوَ سَهُ. فَهُوَ سَهُ. And every time one is quiet, without reflecting and pondering, that's a sign of being heedless. Being heedless. Someone is lost. He's daydreaming of things of the dunya. And that's it, the pure heedlessness, which is, subhanAllah, that heedlessness will have seal later, wal'iyadu billah, in the heart. So when someone is quiet, not speaking, silent, and he's thinking other than contemplating, other than thinking of something, good plan, project, but thinking in the vast creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is heedlessness. قال وما كان من منظر في غير عبرة فهو له. And anything that someone is contemplating or looking at or seeing without getting reflection or without getting lesson or intending to get lesson from it, that is a distraction. And if you see the world of today, subhanAllah, people are daydreaming, so heedless. People are speaking any talk, news to panic people, then vain talk. And people are watching, thinking just to entertain or be distracted. What you have in the end, heart that is filled with layers of darkness, eyes with cover, ears with cover, totally disconnected from the heart, the soul is being drying out because it does not have any light who comes through the heart to have that submission, and whole system of the soul is in chaos, is declining, is collapsing, is dying. And that's how will be for the state of someone who will not be in a state of the dhikr. The few last words to have this dhikr, we need to be help ourselves to remind ourselves to have the dhikr. How can we remind ourselves to have a dhikr? Is to remember why you are here in this life. And this another subject that we do not have the time to go through it, but reading the Quran with contemplation, seeing what Allah is promising and what Allah is threatening for the disbeliever, that it need to be dear and close to our heart. This is the fact to help us want to come back to Allah. If you want to come back to Allah, you're going to question your purpose of life. If you question your purpose of life, then you're going to try to understand the vision of this life. If you understand the vision of your life, then you understand the vision of the whole creation, why Allah created this whole universe. Then you have a focus on what you need to do. That's when you find the need to make the dhikr, because that the dhikr is going to serve you as tools to nourish your soul, to nourish your heart, to nourish your ears, to nourish your eyes, to nourish your hand, to make, subhanAllah, someone who act in a very dynamic, active way in the way of Allah and journeying to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will stop here, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. As I have said, the other third part, it requires a lot of details, so I don't want to throw it without, explaining it. Inshallah, in another opportunity, we will do it. Again, dear brother and respected sister, have the dhikr of Allah, please. The dhikr of Allah is a necessity. We are coming, inshallah, to welcoming soon Ramadan, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us and to guide us and to give us the great favor to do it. By doing that, we'll make Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala, our challenge to be Rabbani. Be Rabbani mean we defeat the fear that we have. We submit to Allah and accept our destiny. Just be pleased with Allah, Allah will be pleased with you. If you will gain that favor to be with Allah, then inshallah and by Allah, you will see that everything will go smooth in your life. And if it's truly in reality, it's the opposite of what people think, you will be still thinking and living the peace of the mind and the satisfaction, the inner satisfaction, insha'Allah ta'ala. Tomorrow, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, we inviting you, insha'Allah ta'ala, to have, we have a preparation for Ramadan. We received some of the question from you, insha'Allah, to go through them. It's going to start at 2, bi-idhnillah. So the preparation for Ramadan is going to be a seminar with Al-Aman and the Islam Day. For those who know the Islam Day, mashallah, and the activity that we have about that, we had the opportunity to have a whole seminar about civilization and going working through the essential of the deen. So tomorrow, bi-idhnillah, from 2, we're going to have this preparation of Ramadan. Some of good challenged or challenging question, alhamdulillah, for people wondering how can we have Ramadan in this challenging time, in this unprecedented time. Inshallah, part of this lecture that we have done have a lot covered a lot of that. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. To free ourselves from the whole, you know, chains of the dunya, from the whole, you know, panic made by people, it helped us really to have a great Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala. So, Ramadan 2020, Saturday, April 18, 2020, is going to be tomorrow, inshallah, at 2, also stream, is going to be on Zoom and also on Facebook, streaming live, and on YouTube. If you have the information, you can use the same information that you have for this lecture that we have now, or go back to the website of Al-Aman, or the emails for those who have, mashallah, have received emails from Al-Aman or from the Islam Day, or reject, just check the page of the Facebook of Al-Aman, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakumullahu khairan wa barakallahu feekum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the power of the iman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the light of the guidance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to illuminate our heart, our soul, our eyes, our ears, and have us to be fully and completely, you know, filled with the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, give us the satisfaction in the heart. Give us the contentment and the submission into the soul. Ya Allah, help us to be pleased with you. And we inquire and ask you, Ya Allah, to be pleased with us. Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, teach us how to be, you know, patient in this time. Teach us, Ya Allah, how to be a good worshipper, Ya Allah. Help us, Ya Allah, to not be panicked and frightened. Ya Allah, give us rizq. You are the razzaq. Ya Allah, guarantee for us the rizq. Do not be in the trap of the shaitan so we fall into the worries and anxiety. Ya Allah, help us to not be sad. Ya Allah, assure and put, you know, in our heart the strength, strengthen our heart, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us to and guide us and give us the favor to be in Ramadan. Ya Allah, reopen our masajid. Ya Allah, do not make, Ya Allah, this pandemic that is spreading all over a sign from you of a torment to drive us out from your rahmah. Ya Allah, we begging you to bring us back to your masjid and to shower us with your rahmah, Ya Allah. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana ajma'in. Allahumma arhamna bi rahmatika ya kareem. Allahumma arfa' anna al-waba. Allahumma akshif anna al-ghum. Allahumma najjina min al-ghum wa akshif anna al-dhur. La ilaha ilanta subhanaka. إنا كنا ظالمين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.